So this time we're going to look at the opening sequence to Beasts of the Southern Wild. The very first thing we see on screen is a pig, which relates to the whole theme of animals and the relationship between animals and people, nature in general, and of course the aurochs, which are played by pigs in the film, though the real animal, the extinct aurochs, were a sort of bull. It might be easy to miss the pig in this very first shot because of the lighting, which we can see is very natural. It's illuminating the hay bale, which we might have our attention drawn to more. But we will notice the general mise-en-scene, which is clutter. And we're going to see a lot of clutter over the rest of the film. We can see tyres. We can see this meeting place, this liminal space between humanity and nature, where we see the trees and the natural world and all the detritus of humanity. The camera angle is very low. It's not a low angle shot, it's just positioned very low so that we are going to be positioned alongside the height perspective of Hushpuppy. She's our narrator for the film, and of course the camera angle helps to emphasise the perspective of Hushpuppy, the world view that she has. We are aligned with her in terms of spectatorship. The shot is handheld, and it tilts ever so slightly to introduce Hushpuppy as she walks into frame. She's literally blown in by the wind, so she's already at the mercy of the elements. And her costume is as much of a mishmash as the existence that we all see that she leads. And this indicates that she makes her own clothing choices and that she is independent. Notably, later on in the sequence, Wink tells her to put some pants on, and we'll discuss that when it arrives. That natural lighting is very noticeable by the fact that her face isn't lit using traditional Hollywood-style three-point lighting. You've got the leaves in the foreground, which makes something of a dirty shot. So already in the very opening shot, we can see that we're not going to be shooting in the classic Hollywood style. We're not given an establishing shot. Exposition is something that we're going to have filled in gradually. Exposition is going to come from Hushpuppy's perspective. So the handheld camera, the natural lighting, and the very unglamorous mise-en-scene are all pointing to a deliberate sense of a documentary-style neorealism. This is a film that's wearing its independent, fairly low-budget credentials on its sleeve. So Hushpuppy reaches out to the pig, which establishes very quickly the motif of connection with nature and the heartbeat narrative, which is going to become very important in the film. Enter this nursery rhyme style music, which we might more typically associate with the horror genre, but here it's clearly used to indicate the sense of childhood, so further drawing us into Hushpuppy's perspective. We cut to this moving shot of chickens, and we get more of the mise-en-scene that's important to the film. This is a film about characters whose life is on the fringes. Hushpuppy's narration begins, which links to the consistent low camera height. Notable, she's got a very colloquial speech pattern, so we're fully brought into her society. The society that we live in is very much othered by Hushpuppy and the film as alien to her, and thus we are immersed in this idea of the life beyond the wall being alien. It's approximately 53 seconds into the sequence when we finally get a good look at Hushpuppy's face as she lifts her head up into the frame. The film doesn't entirely reject Hollywood conventions. It uses what is necessary in terms of film narrative, and there's a clear use of shot reverse shot here. So Hushpuppy looks, and the next shot is what she's looking at from the right angle, the right eyeline match, so that we see what she sees. We're introduced to Wink through a hole. We see his hand throwing a bottle. I think we can probably assume it's beer or alcohol. Is this last night's empties or is this his breakfast? It doesn't say. We can work that one out for ourselves. We hear his voice first, which indicates his position within the film and its narrative structure. He's removed from us. He's not going to be a character with whom we are aligned. This initial shot that crabs right to suggest his movement within his hut, we can't physically see. So this all adds to the idea that Wink is an important character, one who's going to be very relevant to the narrative, but not someone we're going to be aligned with through cinematic means. Here's that line. Wink says, "Put on some pants." The next shot is of her underwear. She hasn't put on pants or trousers. This is suggestive of defiance or independence or the idea of no rules or the relationship between Hushpuppy and Wink. The cut there certainly indicates their relationship in a very, very subtle and quick and quite sly way. So this is our first shot of Wink, and it's shot from Hushpuppy's height perspective. Even if she's not physically present in this scene, we're going to be seeing the whole world of the film through her eyes. So even though she's not present, her worldview is consistent. Notice the interior of his hut is cramped, all this mismatched furniture, framing is very tight. You can see a cat screen left there. We've got the idea of living life on the fringes going on. This is an interesting cut coming here. We cut on action, so the movement of his arm sutures the two shots together, but actually the action he's performing is different, so there's a slight jump in time there, but we don't notice it. The next cut is far more traditional. As he opens the door, we cut to an exterior shot. So again, we're using Hollywood conventions when they're appropriate for clear storytelling. Notice that as he opens the door, we can see how embedded with nature their existence is, with the trees that surround the house, also providing something of a dirty shot by being out of focus in the front of the frame. So the world of humanity and the world of nature is established again, this liminal space that the bathtub folk live. There's another cut on action as he's ringing the bell. We also get our first indication that they have separate homes, the surprising independence that Hushpuppy lives in. We then see this extremely short montage. We see the animals feeding and then Hushpuppy feeding. So feed up time has referred to both feeding the animals and feeding themselves. Clearly the connection there is established. So overall, we've really introduced the world that we're going to be immersed in for the rest of the film, and we've established Hushpuppy's character perspective.